them names?
Yeah, they called a name, and I called Yard of W. Ryan. I stepped forward, and down the gangplank we went. And that first sergeant says, "Where have you been?" I said, "I've been here all the time." when we got on the land and back into to Camp Stone, okay, you got to get on the train. We go into Shelby, Mississippi. Half of the train was Shelby, Mississippi. The other one was to a port and a camp in New York, Camp Lejeune, someplace in New York. When we got to Denver, Colorado, it was all right, 2 or 3 days riding on the train. We got to Denver, Colorado. Half the train turned and went to Mississippi. The other half went to New York. When we got to Camp Shelby in Mississippi, the half of the train that come to us had all the clothes and equipment and everything for New York. And the New York train had everything for Camp Shelby, Mississippi. So it was just us and nothing. No records, no nothing. It was all. They said, "Okay, you got too many people here. Too many soldiers. We can't discharge you. You have to get your new set of uniforms and go home. We'll call home when it's time to discharge you." So I came home. And in 3 days I got married.
Right, 2 weeks.
We had to tell the priest. They had to post it three Sundays in a row for your wedding. So the second one, they just announced it three times in church. That made three. And we got married.
At the cathedral?
We got married in it's now the cathedral. It was an out of conception, now it's a cathedral in Lake Charles. And
what year was that?
In 1945. September the 9th.
58 years ago?
Yep. September 9th. 45, and that's 58 years to the day. Yeah, we got married. That was crowning glory. 5 years of service and it was gone. Thank God.
They never called you back?
Nope, they were supposed to. They could have. I mean, it was said if the war wasn't over, we was coming back. But when I come under the Golden Gate Bridge in the ship, and they started blowing the whistles and the music and the horns went off and everything, the war was over. I threw everything over. All my records except one. Everything went over. I wasn't going back to Saipan. I knew that. Oh, no. But we married. Our honeymoon was in Arkansas, and we stayed in on the honeymoon, and we was calling every night and calling back 2 or 3 days, calling back home, and Mama said. Told them one time they wanted me in Camp Shelby, Mississippi to discharge. Get a discharge, it was time. And I got back. And
we bought a car though, remember?
And yeah, we had an old Oldsmobile. We got to discharge, and there was about Louisiana men, it was the first time we'd ever seen them. They wanted to ride. When we left, they wanted to ride. They wanted to ride with us. We said, well, we're going to Gulfport, Mississippi. And then we was coming home. They wanted to ride with us. So it was a man by the name of Coco. I don't know the third fellow. The second
Steve
one was
Stefani Hack and Sterling Simmons.
I knew Coco. But what was his name?
Enos Sturley's.
To this day, I've never seen him. But when we landed, when we left, and we drove him to Mississippi, to this day, I got a saddle fight with that man if I ever seen him. Because when they left, we went to a hotel. And them monkeys let all the air out of my tires, all four of them, in front of the hotel. If I ever see Enos Sturley's one of these days, I'm gonna settle that right there.
Why'd they do that?
Just to practice. Acting crazy. Sure was having fun. We was all having fun. They thought that was something. I had a heck of a time getting air in them tires. In them days, you know, they didn't have filling stations and all like they have now. There wasn't a filling station. We went that poor man, he said, yeah, I got a compressor in the back of the car. Come up there and fill the tires on it. But that was wonderful.
Then you got back, and where'd you live at in Lake Charles?
We came back to Lake Charles actually, we was here for. Where did we live first? Did we live with Cousin Annie first?
She went off to bed.
Yeah, I don't remember. We'll have to start this again after a while.
Gonna take a break?
Yeah.
So you got married, and then where did you live?
When we came home from the discharge, we were offered a place to stay with my cousin Annie. Actually, she was a cousin to my daddy and was my godmother. He was E.L. Emily and cousin Annie were godfather and godmother to me. And we stayed in their house 3 months?
About 4 months.
4 months? Yeah. And then at the time I was working on the ships that were docked in the river, upriver, that they were selling, the government was selling, and we were in charge of. They had a whole flock of 100 men that was there from service, and we were on 3 shifts, night, evening, and night, day, evening, and night, to guard those ships so that nothing would be taken off of them or anything like that. And that's where I met most of the men coming back from service. And at that time is when Skip, my brother, was in the employment office and he got the word from PPG that it was time to start hiring people. And that's what that was one of his main things. Then he called me and he said, go to PPG and see Walker Melton. They were hiring. And when I went and talked to Walker Melton, and I went back to Lake Charles, into Lake Charles to get a physical examination to go to work. And And I went back out there, and I was there about 2 or 3 days. And Walter Melton called me back in and said, "You know where any more of those people like you are?" And I said, "Yeah, the woods is full of them." So I went back out, and I must have helped hire at least 8, maybe 10 of the men that were out there. That's where Jack and I got together. Jack Bond and I got together because we were good buddies on the boats that we were guarding. He was on the same boat that I was on and the same ship. But when I went back out, they said, "Who are you? Well, you know where some old men are?" And I got down and said, "Yeah, you better come." It was about 8 of us that I knew: Davis, Jack Vaughn, Bailey, Brasher. They were all out there. I said, "Come on." Of course, they were all just like I was, just right out of service, so there was no, wasn't hard to do. And we stayed at that time with my wife's aunt and Lily Hardis in the garage apartment. And at the same time, we were negotiating to buy a house. After a few months, we bought the house on Lucille Street, 2 blocks off of Ryan, a brand new subdivision.
146
Lucille Street. There was nothing at that time in that area. Nothing. There was no mall. That was all just woods, prairie.
Horses were roaming.
There was nothing. Our street was the end of the
civilization.
Paved road. Yeah, there was nothing.
Our house was the 5th house built on that block.
Yeah, it was nothing. I mean, at nighttime, horses would come, and cows would come in the yard, and the horse would rub himself on the side of the house, wake you up, and that. There was nothing. We stayed there 10 years. We lived in the house 10 years. And Irene was born 47. 1947.
August the 6th, 1947.
Yeah. And
2 years after the atomic bomb was built.
Yeah, it was 2 years after the war. After the war ended.
No, after the bomb fell.
We had decided then that we wanted to get closer to the school. The kids went to St. Margaret's. We went to St. Margaret's Church, and that was on Boulevard. At the time, it was on Bank Street, and then it moved to Boulevard. The church did. We bought a home at the end of Enterprise Boulevard. Before you get to Priam Lake, the last block of Enterprise Boulevard.
Honey, we had the first trade-in. We traded in.
Yes,
the like you do a car.
Yeah. At that time, the Reinhard Real Estate would take the house that you were living in as a down payment and negotiate to buy the home you wanted, and it's like trading in a car.
I don't think they do that anymore.
And it worked? Oh, no. I don't think so. And it worked because our house, after 10 years, was...
We bought it for $65,000?
Yeah, yeah.
We sold it. It was valued at $10,000.
Yeah.
So we lived there 10 years and made money off it.
Yeah, it was a very good deal for us. And the home on Boulevard was naturally closer to the school and the church, and it was altogether different. And it was only 3 years old when we bought it the first time. Yeah. What's the name?
Well, tell me back about your childhood growing up. Who were your friends as a child?
He didn't tell you anything about his football career.
Yeah, tell us about the football.
Well, actually, in early days, earlier than that.
You started at St. Charles.
Yeah, but in earlier days, when I was 6 and 7 on Mill Street, there was, that was a dirt street then. Mill Street was a dirt street. A little bit of gravel in it. But there was a family, two houses down, the Shepherd family. It was Clifton and George Shepherd. And we played together all the time. It was really a lot of fun.
And that was during the Depression years?
Oh, yes. This was in...
That was a little bit before the Depression.
It was in 33, 34. It was...
Go back to younger than that. You were born in 1918.
Well, yeah. It was in 20, I was just 2 years old then. No baby.
Go back to when you started school. And Lily might walk you to school every morning.
From where we were at on Mill Street to the St. Charles Academy on Ryan Street, the school that Lily Mae and I went to, was a long walk, and we walked every day. We walked to school and from school. I know Lily Mae would bring me to school.
She was 4 years older than you.
Yeah, and I was, she was 4 years older than me. And I was almost back home when she got to school. Well, I didn't like to go.
It took him a whole year to teach him to go to school.
But at the third grade level, Landry Memorial opened up, had been open for a year or so. And in grade 3, I went to Landry. It's an all-boys Christian Brothers Catholic school. And it had just started before that, not too many years.
So St. Charles turned to all girls?
All girls.
And you left.
It was always all girls, but had the first, second, and third grade was girls and boys.
Oh.
And then at the third grade level, we went to Landry.
Dennis was in the last graduating class with boys from St. Charles.
Yes. Well, I was in 30.
But he was 8 years older than me.
Yeah. It was in 30 something when he graduated.
Yeah.
But when I went to Landry, all boys, and it was.
You have lifelong friends.
It was a brand new school, and the gym had just been built. The gymnasium had just been built, and it had the four grades in one side of the upstairs. Still that way. So it was third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, and then you went into to the big school. But they are
and at that time,
friends right now. In Lake Charles, that I was in school with then. And about five or six of those families and men still live in Lake Charles. When we graduated from in high school, we were all close together because the number of people in the class, the graduation class, was only 15. That's how many people was in the class. About 15. And so we were close together.
Did you have a
my years in the higher up grades up to 9th, 10th, 11th school I spent all year there, every day, summer and winter, because the swimming pool was there.
You and your dog.
The swimming pool was there.
And you and your dog.
And my dog was there.
What was your dog's name?
Towser.
And what was special about him?
Well, Towser, in the school then, there was no such thing as air conditioning and all that stuff. The school doors was open and the windows was open. Windows were big old French windows from the floor to the ceiling. You could walk through the windows as well as you could the door.
Tell me about Bobby Bailey riding his horse.
Yes, sir. He'd ride his horse right up to the door. Ride his bicycle right up to the door. But my dog, Towser, when the bell rang, would know from one room to the other where I was going. He would beat me to the, down the hall and to the next room. Sit out in the hall. In fact,
they gave him a diploma.
When I graduated from school, they gave Towser a diploma. Yes, sir. When I left for service, Twatchman was one of our buddies that lived down the street, our family buddies that lived down the street on Ryan Street for me. And he got all my stuff when I went to the war. He had my beautiful jacket that I had for years because it had every stripe, and had the Landry letter on the front, and it had all the hash marks on the side that I had been in school with. And when my dog died, he buried my dog in that.
Oh no!
In that.
Jacket.
Beautiful jacket. Yes, sir. I wish I had it to this day. But we are still, it's five men still grown families that still close together that are here in Lake Charles from the class of 1939 in Landry.
Who's that? What's their names?
Charles Richard. He was assistant district attorney when he retired. Charlie Levesque, he worked for a lumber company on North Ryan Street.
David
Sachendover. And Frank Turnover. Frank was self-employed. He worked for himself. And Carl Steen Coco was the manager and owner of Coco Shoe Store. And me.
And
James Dufran, his daddy, owned the Dufran's coffee shop and restaurant.
Rock's Cafe.
Rock's Cafe on Ryan Street, right around the corner from the church on Ryan Street. And James was an insurance executive when he retired. They're all still living with one. Coco passed away. All the rest of them still live.
And they still, to this day,
we see each other most of the time once a year. For somehow we get together and somebody makes a phone call and then we have our little get together. Last year it was only four of us that got together. Coco was sick. They didn't have it. Talk about old times and school times and how far I could kick a football. And I have a picture of me kicking a football with all the men standing around at practice.
He could have played professional ball.
It was great fun. Well, I had a chance to go to college and I had hurt my knees bad, both of them, but one of them was real bad. At that time, the coach at LSU was Bernie Moore, and he said, no, you can't play ball. You get hurt, crippled for life. He said, that's best for you to find you some other kind of sport, not football. And so I could have gotten to college. I could have gotten a scholarship to play, but at that time, no, bad legs, couldn't do it.
He could stand on the 50-yard line and kick a field goal.
Oh, yeah.
He was good.
Oh, yeah. Josh Daly was on the team with us. Josh played in, and he would come back every night, and I would kick, and he'd come back every night and say, "Doggone it, Josh, you don't have to kick it that far." He was plumb out of breath. Yeah. We played Lafayette Cathedral was a Catholic school in Lafayette. We played them every year. They was pretty well beating the devil out of us. But I was on about the middle field, somewhere on 40-yard line, 50-yard line, and we couldn't do nothing. The coach sent word in there, kick it. Coach Curry said, "We're gonna kick it." They didn't know what we was gonna do, so I kicked. When he finally caught up with it, he was on the goal line.
Oh no.
That's where the game ended, right there. We stopped them all right there. They didn't run out of time. We had kicked the ball so far that there was no way they were gonna make a touchdown, and we wasn't gonna let them. Game ended.
How did you get your nickname?
Huh?
How did you get your nickname?
Oh yeah, well now that's another. The name, my nickname Jug was originally started Jughead because Coach Curry said they would throw what was known as a helmet in them days. You didn't have to wear it, it wasn't mandatory. But they would throw this piece of leather in there called a helmet, and I couldn't stand it. I'd wear it one play and phew, out of here. Coach said, "Jug, you're going to get killed if you don't wear something on that head, because every time you run into the line, I can hear your head, it rings like an empty jug, like a jug." So they started calling me Jug Head. And then, of course, a year or two after that, the head was dropped. And this was in 1938. And from then on, it's been Joe Ryan, everywhere. I was in service, nobody knew. I was in service for over a year, I guess, when we landed in Honolulu, and I was going down the ramp, and there was another ship alongside of us going up the ramp, and he recognized me. Frank Turnover was in our class, and he was leaving Honolulu, and we was landing, and he was coming off, and he saw me, and he hollered, "Hey, Joe!" And the fellow behind me in our company said, "What did he call you?" I said, "He called me Joe." And it started right there. The company of 200 men in just a few days, it was all Joe Ryan. And so everywhere I have been in my whole life, it's been Joe Ryan. When I went to PPG, went to work, the second man that come up there to be hired, and I had told him, "Go get hired," said, "Hey, Joe." The guy's around there said, "What'd he call you?" I said, "Joe." And nobody knew me at PPG for years. It's George Ryan, they say it's Joe. And to this day, it's Joe.
So you started PPG in 47?
Yep.
As what? What were you doing first?
Actually, we were, everybody that was hired in 47, in the service department, they call it, or the maintenance department, every man out there was called a service mechanic. Regardless of what you did, you were a service mechanic, because that was everybody called mechanic. And of course, you was a service mechanic electrician, a service mechanic painter, or a service mechanic any of the craft instrument. And that's what I started, a service mechanic. I was there in September 17th, 1947, when I walked in the door. And that was almost a month before the plant actually started. The plant started in October 7th, 1947. It's when we got the salt water from the salt water mines in Sulphur to start making caustic. That's the first thing you make, salt water, and then from then on you make chlorine. And
it was called, what was the name back then?
And the name of the plant then was Southern Alcohol. And then it changed, after about 4 or 5 years, it changed to Columbia Southern. And that was when it was between PPG and another company. And then Columbia Southern was bought completely out by PPG Industries in about 1957, and from then on it's been PPG, wholly owned and operated. And they don't make glass, they make chlorine and caustic. At that time, that's what we was making, chlorine and caustic. And now they make propylene, chloroethylene, they make silica.
PVC?
They make
PVC part chemicals, don't they?
PPG is PPG Lake Charles is a chemical plant. It's not a glass plant. It's chemical. All chemical. The biggest one that PPG's got in the United States is Lake Charles.
So you worked on all the machinery, all over the plant?
Worked on compressors and turbines and boilers in the whole plant for 15 years, 16 years. And at that time, it was time to go from a foreman, from a plant mechanic to a foreman. The plant was growing and they were setting up people and they needed. So they set me up as mechanical foreman in a powerhouse. And as I worked there as a mechanical foreman for 17 more years, total 34 years.
And mostly in the powerhouse.
All my work was in the powerhouse until the last 2 months that I was there. They had wanted to break another man in as power foreman in the powerhouse, and they just transferred me to the maintenance department on incoming machinery. I was to unload the machinery, and I did for 2 years unload all the new cells that was manufactured in Africa in can't think of the name, but anyhow the material was made in Sierra Leone and it was called titanium. We had never heard of it. The cells were made in titanium. They were shipped from Sierra Leone to New Orleans, Louisiana. Put it on big old trucks and hauled to Lake Charles. And my job for 2 years was to unload them at the port, deliver them to the plant every day.
And what did you do with the crating material left over?
Oh, that well, at the port of Lake Charles, where they come in, they were in a box, a crate, beautiful wood crate. The wood was semi-planed, it wasn't smooth, semi-planed, and it was a special wood. It was called what we call balsa, but it was really not balsa, it was another kind of tree. But the boards were 1 inch thick, plain, 1 inch thick. There were some 10 inches wide, some 15 inches wide, some 4 inches wide, and they put them together to make a crate. The crates were 7 by 7 by 10, 7 feet high, 7 feet wide, and 10 feet long. Two-thirds of that inside was the new chlorine cell. The other half of it was parts of that cell. And when we started tearing them apart, lumber was piling up in one side of the building, and fireman came. He was also, his name was Dean. We were in school together, and he said, "Joe, you can't have this. The fire people's insurance people say that's got to go." So I went back to the company and told them, and the company said, "Don't you bring that wood in here. Don't bring that in here. We've got enough trouble as it is without having a wood pile in here to have to burn or give away." I said, "Okay, I'll take it to the camp." They said, "No, you can't go but 20 miles from the camp. That's as far as the insurance will let you drive a truck." I said, "Well, it's 20 miles." It was, too.
Yeah.
And so every day, or every other day, for at least a year, I took a load of wood from the warehouse where we were storing it to the camp and unloaded it. They didn't want me to bring it in the camp. No way, no way. And the wood was actually a light green because it was sprayed in Africa, wherever they, Sierra Leone is where it came from, but they sprayed.
Funny, I thought it was from Italy.
It was in.
It was from Africa?
It was, yeah. The Sierra Leone, wherever that is, that might be in Italy. Is it?
I thought you told me that.
It's just where it came from. Sierra Leone was written all over the case.
Well, that's where it was shipped from.
Yeah. But anyhow,
You said that it was
all the wood that was come from there for at least a year was going to the camp in a truckload every day, or every other day, and that's what the camp was built with.
And all he had was a handsaw and hammer.
Yep.
Okay.
We built it out there, that's what it was.
I gotta move my closet so you can take the truck.
Okay.
So built a two-story camp down on...
It is now. At first it was a single story with a boat slip on one side, 18 by 10, and the other side was 18 square. That was the kitchen, dining room, and living. That's all we had at first. And then the front part of it, you remember the front part, because that the pavement, you were there when we paved the front of it. It's 10 foot wide and 28 feet long. And that's where the two-story came. First one story, and it looked like a driving. Because it had a flat roof. And then we put top story on it 4 or 5 years after that. But all that wood was what the strange thing about it was not supposed to be good, the wood. You could pick up a 10 foot wide piece, 1 inch thick, 10 foot long, with one hand.
Hmm.
It was like balsa wood. That's what we called it, but it wasn't balsa wood. But you could drive a nail in it, and you couldn't pull a nail out. It just grabbed the wood.
Tough stuff.
The camp is still there. This was in 1980, and the camp's still there, so it must be pretty good wood. But everything was good.
So you retired?
I retired from the plant after 34 years in 1981 as a maintenance foreman. 17 years working, 17 years of foreman. 34 years.
Well, what kind of work have you done since then?
When I retired in 1981, I retired. But I have completed the house. I have did carpenter work. I have did painting work. I have did cement work all around the house. You have had three different boats. Now we've got a pontoon boat.
Tell me about your first boat.
The John boat was a metal aluminum boat. Flat bottom, about 15 feet long, had a 25 horse Mercury. Had two young grandsons and a son-in-law. And every time they used the boat, then it come back broke. Come back messed up. I would take it apart. The motor. 15 horse Johnson. Evinrude, they called it. Johnson. I'd have to tear it to pieces, put it back together, tie it in the alley, come down, go fishing. Be down there 2 days, Saturday and Sunday, paddling it back. Didn't want to run. Wouldn't start. Tear it all apart, fix it again. He'd come back next week, do the same thing. Then we got the fiberglass boat. That was really something. It had a 115 Mercury on the back of it. Had to tear it apart two or three times. Fixed the bottom end of the foot. Hit a boat, hit a stump, hit a mud or something, tear it all to pieces. That fixed. That thing lasted, oh, I don't know, 5 years, I guess, 4 years. Then we got the 20-foot pontoon. That thing's over 10 years old now. 12 years old. Uh oh.
Keep talking.
We got the pontoon is 20. Has a 15 horse Mercury on the back of it. And it's just right for a family boat.
Did I miss the part about the big boat you had?
No, the fiberglass boat was
what about the KDM?
Well, that was the first boat we had in Lake Charles, and at the camp was the Chris Craft 20-foot Chris Craft old wooden boat, cabin cruiser is what it was. It's a Chris Craft cabin cruiser.
Did you buy that new?
It was, oh Lord, no, that thing was 30 years old when we bought it.
Mahogany.
It was mahogany boat, but it was old. But we had that, what, 5 years, six? When we bought that, well, we had the boat in 1971, because that's when we had the camp. That's when the camp started.
No, we bought that boat, no. Your mom died in 72, my mom died in 73. We bought the camp in 74. But we had the boat. Yeah, you're right. We had,
because Mimi
went on that.
That's boat. Right. Sure. Yeah. We had the boat.
We kept it at Olmsted Shipyard.
Yeah, we had the boat in Olmsted Shipyard in 1971 or two. Yeah.
Mimi was on that boat.
Well, it was good. It was all mahogany, but it was very old, soaked. The wood had been soaked and soaked and soaked and soaked. It made the boat as half again as heavy as it was to start with. If we could have took it out of water and let it dry on a, what you call it, somewhere, it would have probably been a good boat. It was soaked.
I think we made a mistake when we painted the inside so you could see the motor.
Yeah.
I really think that's a problem because you're not supposed to paint mahogany.
Oh, it's supposed to trap the water?
It sealed it. It sealed the water and it was way heavy. Heavy.
That was one of the mistakes we made.
But it.
But you had a lot of fun on it.
Oh, yes.
Oh,
we
yeah.
I think.
It kind of took me a while.
What started the whole boat after we had it and enjoyed it in Lake Charles, then we had the camp. And to get to the camp, you had to go down a canal to get to the camp. The ditch, we called it, was a canal. And sometimes it was had 15, 18 inches of water in it, and the boat took that all the time because it had that prop underneath it. And so it was gradually tearing things up. But we put it on the ways at Moss Lake and had it repaired, fixed up, put it back in the water. And we used it a year.
We have pictures somewhere of Sheila and Jennifer the baby coming down there while we were painting
in
those waters.
Oh yeah, it was the years get away from me, but the kids all had a good time, very good time. And it served out its term in Moss Lake. When I got rid of it, it was given to a man and lived in Sulphur. And it served its term out in Moss Lake. It tore to pieces on an island that's right in Moss Lake. That's where it landed. The end of it was it just sunk and went all to pieces.
But
right
didn't
there.
We get the transom?
We got one piece of wood. One piece of wood at the camp. The transom end of it. Yeah.
Caught a lot of fish on that boat.
Oh, yeah.
Well, let's go.
Mark's kids, Mark's brothers, was on there. And also Leon. Leon was on the boat with all the family when we hit the log in Lake Charles coming to the camp. And by the time I got to Olmsted Shipyard where the boat we had boat docked, it was sinking.
Yep.
And I didn't even know it. I mean I knew it taking on water. But I didn't know it was sinking. We put it on the waves that night. And it was sinking. And that started the downfall of it. We had it a year after that, but it was dangerous to use. It was just falling to pieces. But it was still fun.
Now let's go back a little bit. Tell me where you met your wife.
Oh, God. I don't even know the year, but it had to be in when was Cyril at the pool?
1938. You were a big boy and I was a little kid, you didn't even look.
In 1938, Cyril, her brother,
you were friends with Curtis
and Curtis was in my class. Curtis was in our class. But Cyril was in charge of the running of the pool behind on Landry Memorial's grounds. It was the Landry pool. School
it was
pool.
The only swimming pool in Lake
the only
Charles.
Pool in Lake Charles. And he run it.
He was the lifeguard.
And she was there every day. What do you call it? Let's see. The lifeguard said, she was a
She was a hot chick in a bikini?
No, she was
a tadpole.
Yeah, a tadpole.
I was called tadpole.
Yeah, she was a tadpole. And that was in 38.
And he surely didn't look at me then.
No. Well, it was about that time. She growed up and I did too.
But, what did your buddy say that you did?
But that's what Frank. Frank said I robbed the cradle. But that was in 1938. And of course, I went to the war in 39, lasted 39 in the early 40, and stayed 5 years, and then we come back to
the war. We started dating in 1941.
Yeah, 1940.
41. You were in service.
Well, it lasted 40, yeah. Because I was in service in December 40.
Well, yeah, that's what I say. We started dating in 41.
Yeah.
You were walking down Ryan Street by Fordham's. I was in Curtis's old car, Teeny Jean, with a carload of girls. And I said, hey, isn't he cute? Yeah, I'm speaking. Hey, Jug, you want to ride? And that's where it started. And you were the back seat, and my girlfriend, Doc, was looking at you, and you were looking at her, and I thought, ooh, I got to do something here. I said, you want to ride? And he said, yeah, I'll drive. So we drove, and we drove up on Lakeshore Drive,
yeah.
And we had a flat. And you said, oh, I'll go get it fixed. And I thought, yeah, right. We're going to be, these girls and I are going to be here all night. With no heat coming back.
But he did fix the flat.
He did.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's where we started.
So what kind of things did you do when you were dating?
Walk.
Walk to
we
the
had
movies,
we
walk
had no we had
movies.
No transportation. So in Lake Charles, you walked everywhere.
We
when
walked.
You wanted to go somewhere, we left. They lived on 4th Street, right
remember,
behind the, right behind the stadium, right behind
line.
Lake Charles Stadium, football stadium, and we would walk from there to Borden's ice cream or to Watson's ice cream. Yeah, and we would
split.
We would split
50 cents frappe with
yeah.
two straws.
It was a great big old drink cost 50 cents, and with two straws, that's what we drank.
Well, that was a lot back then.
And when you wanted to go somewhere, you got up and walked. We had no transportation at all.
We walked to the grocery store. We walked. To
yeah,
church,
we walked
to
the grocery
town.
Store. We walked. Everywhere. We walked to church.
But back then you could walk anywhere in Lake Charles any time of day.
Oh yeah, there was no.
I wouldn't let my girls do that when they were coming up.
No, it was country then, real country. Nothing to worry about. But
so
it was a lot of fun. Yeah. That's enough story.
I think.